Watertown, New York is a lot of families who are active in golf, going back into the 60s and 70s, and it's been a kind of a tradition up here.
I married into golf, so I'm very used to being around golf.
This area has a lot of very, very good golfers, and the tradition seems to be continuing.
I guess I don't have a recollection of when golf wasn't a part of Michael's life. And now he's at the point he lives, eats, sleeps, and breathes golf.
Cena and I both wanted to have, you know, several kids, and we just thought it'd be very simple, but wasn't the case. Cindy suffered her first miscarriage. When she got pregnant the fourth time, I think she was at about 28 weeks. I got the phone call that she was bleeding again.
I assumed this was it. It was happening again. I assumed that my baby was gone. And when the paramedics came and they said they heard a heartbeat, I was amazed. They rushed me to Syracuse Hospital, where they have an antepartum unit, which does everything they can to prevent you from delivering. And I was like that for 2 weeks. They gave me shots to strengthen Michael's lungs, and they held me off for 2 weeks when I delivered him 10 weeks early, and he wasn't able to breathe on his own. And I was scared to death.
I'm sitting next to her, and she looked up at me, and I just knew I needed to comfort her because she was so scared. I could see it in her eyes.
And Sandy was that reassurance that I was looking for, that if the worst were to happen, that she was there, but yet she was going to do the best she could to prevent the worst from happening.
You think it's the happiest time in your life when you're having a baby, but so much can go wrong.
Well, I remember when Michael was first born, we got to look at him for about maybe 5 seconds.
They took him, they whisked him past me and let me look at him really quickly. And all I could think of was, I want to make sure that the baby I'm seeing is my baby. And I looked down and I saw this beautiful little face with long dark eyelashes. And that's what I remembered. And then they took him from me. He was originally breathing on his own. Within the night, he crashed and he ended up on a respirator. And what they tell you is the next 72 hours will tell, because it can go either way.
And as a preemie, they can pick up an infection. And it can turn into overwhelming sepsis, and just like that, a baby can die from sepsis.
They test for brain bleeds, because you want to make sure there's no bleeding on the brain. They test for retinopathy of prematurity in the eyes. It can affect their vision from being on oxygen for long periods of time. There are all kinds of issues that can come up, even if they survive. That, you know, you don't know. What are the ramifications of this? And I thank God every day that really Michael had none.
Obviously he pulled through and it changed our lives forever. We're very thankful from that.
When I tell people that he was a preemie, they say, no way. But when I think back to how tiny he was, you know, I mean, think of a 5-pound bag of sugar. Well, he was 3 pounds, 6 ounces.
Back then, 3 pounds was serious, and, you know, we shipped them out and they went to Syracuse. Now we keep them here. Technology has come along. We've got a much better equipment now, and that's thanks to Children's Miracle Network, too. They help out there.
At the time, I was no stranger to Children's Miracle Network because I worked on their broadcast for the TV station where I work. I was certainly well aware of CMN. I was well aware of Samaritan Medical Center. But it's one of those cliches, you never think it's going to be you that's going to need it. I thank anyone who's willing to contribute to Children's Miracle Network, which helps these facilities have what they need to make miracles like Michael happen.
So many babies have gone through here. You look at them and you think that I may be taking care of the next president or the next Masters champion. You never know.